So he did. actually it was 40 years ago that the school was started. But we're so grateful that we can get together. And I was thinking the other day, why is it that we have to wait till somebody passes away to get together and reminisce? It would be wonderful if we could, you know, once every 2 or 3 or 4 years get together with all our friends and talk about things and the old times, etc. And I hadn't seen Casey for a long time, and it was actually at a funeral. Lee Hooker, some of you know Lee, had his service out in Redlands, and Casey was there, and we visited and had a nice time catching up again. But we're grateful that you're here today, and we're going to celebrate Casey's life, watch these pictures up here, and remember kind of how it was in the old days. And it's just great to see so many friends here supporting Debbie and the girls. So I want to, by the way, the brochure here, we'll just follow along, and those of you that have a part, just come up whenever your time is on the program here. I invite you to pray with me now as we pray. Dear Lord, in the midst of our sorrow, we lift our hearts in gratitude for your loving presence that surrounds us in this sanctuary today. Thank you for each caring touch, each whispered word of comfort shared in the memory of Casey. We're held by your strength in this gathering, finding comfort in the security of the community that Casey so warmly cherished. May the love you have brought here today surround Debbie and the girls and all of us, Casey's family and friends, and continue to guide our paths through this grief, and forever keep Casey's memory alive in our hearts as we remember him. In Jesus' name.
We read from 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 to 18.
But I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope.
For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him.
For this we may say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep.
For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first.
Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord.
Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
Timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. To the
know I don't look it, but I love being here. I love being here in my dad's church. This is a special place to our family. We remember when my dad turned the church courtyard into a living nativity. On Christmas Saturday. As kids, we were excited about all the animals. And my dad's personal favorite animal at the Living Nativity, the guinea pigs. My dad tried to make everything fun and memorable for us, not just for Madison and I, but for all the kids in his life. I could tell you stories about Jim and Dad and their plane catching on fire in the air, hunting for buried treasure in the Caribbean, taking a bath in Jell-O, winter night's delight of stinky cheese dinner, Ray, I'm looking at you, buying me fuzzy paint rollers because I thought it was a kitty. Getting cauliflower mixed up with cottage cheese. How he met his oldest friends, even before they were born. And his starring role in Disneyland's Golden Horseshoe Review. One magical Christmas morning, my sister and I experienced a surprise that remains vividly etched in our memories. When we woke up, the familiar surroundings of our old bedroom had transformed into something extraordinary. We woke up in new brass sleigh beds. We had not fallen asleep in them. How did we get there? Santa. Santa must have been busy all night, because the surprise extended to the entire room, creating an enchanting scene. Here's what we woke up to. Two exquisitely handcrafted, hand-painted, three-story dollhouses, one for each of us. Brand new desks, complete with reading lights and custom upholstered chairs. We awoke in the beds that were beautifully adorned with custom linens and pillows. And even the window seat in our bedroom had a new cushion, all with brand new matching fabric. And the magic didn't stop in our bedroom that Christmas morning. As we ventured into our backyard, a two-story custom playhouse had been delivered on Christmas Eve by Santa. How we didn't wake up and spoil the surprise was a big part of that miracle. My parents put everything into creating this enchanting surprise, and my grandparents and uncles probably put in extraordinary efforts to help them give us the most special Christmas morning possible. The love and dedication that went into that moment continues to resonate with me. A testament to the lengths my dad would go to make our Christmas truly magical. This is why Madison and I still believe in Santa to this day. My dad loved surprises. And one of the most memorable ones was when he orchestrated a grand surprise dinner for my mom on her 40th birthday. His mission was clear. He wanted to create a moment of pure joy for her. Madison and I got to help. The magnitude of that surprise was evident in the guest list. Ray and Rosie, Dukesa and Devere, E and Ellen, Afonzalos, Eddie, Judy and Dwight, Warren Dale, Laura and Mickey, Robin Vandermolen, Grace and Joe, our grandparents, our whole family, and the others. As the surprise unfolded, my dad reveled in the delight of watching my mom's face light up with shock and happiness. Squeals of total surprise and her trademark laugh. We have no pictures of him that night. He was taking the pictures. He was capturing that magical moment on camera, a snapshot of my mom's genuine joy, surprise, and unrestrained happiness. In that instance, my dad didn't just give a gift. He created a memory that would forever be etched in our hearts. It was a testament to his love for surprises, and more importantly, his deep love for my mom. We're steps away from where Madison and I went to school. Rudy Torres and my dad were an integral part of the genesis of A-plus school. This endeavor wasn't just about growing our community and a Christian education. It was a heartfelt decision that allowed my sister and I to be close to him throughout the entire week while he carried out his pastoral duties. My dad wanted his daughters close by. Ray's sister Lynette was my kindergarten teacher. A-plus school was the only school Madison ever attended in California. This place feels like home. It was a defining moment in our family when my sister, Madison, faced some bullying in the first grade. In the face of trouble, she responded with resilience, courage, and a punch. A punch that resonated far beyond the playground. The news reached my dad through an unexpected phone call from the very people who worked with him, the staff from A-plus. Madison had taken matters into her own hands to protect herself from emotional harm. Yet rather than reprimanding her, my dad chose differently. He picked her up from school and in a gesture of unwavering support, he took her out for ice cream. In that simple act of kindness, my dad demonstrated that he valued his daughter's ability to stand up for herself He was not concerned with the school's call. Instead, he was proud of Madison's courage to protect her heart. Interestingly, I don't recall my sister ever resorting to violence again. I don't remember. She did. However, the lasting impact was not in the punch thrown for Madison, but in the pride my dad felt for his daughter's ability to assert herself. It was a powerful lesson in resilience, support, in the importance of standing up for yourself, and that ice cream can solve most of our problems. Being a dad to my sister Madison was more fun than being a dad to me. My sister was braver and loved fun physical activities. Madison and my dad would jump off the deck at the lake together. She would eagerly hop in the water with him and go water skiing, or go head first down the ski slopes. No poles, just speed. It was more fun with Madison, and my dad loved it. Meanwhile, what do you do with a daughter like me? I wanted makeup birthday parties and days at Disneyland, not classic cars or climbing the stairs at Chichen Itza like he did. I'm struck at my dad's unwavering enthusiasm to embrace and celebrate the things I enjoyed too. He didn't just throw me a makeup birthday party. He approached it with the same fervor and excitement as any other activity. I can vividly recall the grand birthday party he and my mom organized, with tables filled with makeup for me to explore and enjoy. It was a testament to his willingness to dive into the world of super girly interests, ensuring that I felt seen and celebrated. He always made sure that Madison enjoyed it too. While Brittany, Julia, and I were opening lip glosses and eyeshadows, these two, he made sure that Madison and David were getting slathered in green paint to look like Ninja Turtles. For nearly two decades, my dad and I had the privilege of working together. First, he was my boss, then my client, and finally, my creative collaborator. He relied on me and leaned on me to help him in his business. Our deep bond as father and daughter strengthened from our constant combined daily tasks. In the midst of his busy schedule, he would steal moments away, asking me to meet him for a walk on the beach. I talked to him every day, and I loved it extra when it wasn't about work. I found comfort in these stolen moments. The beach became a sanctuary for us, a place where he could momentarily set aside the demands of work and just be himself with me. A place where he could speak freely or simply enjoy the sound of the ocean waves. The beach offered a reprieve from the mounting pressures he constantly faced, and he would go often. During my recent difficult times, my dad was so patient and kind with me. Reflecting back, I can see that his unconditional love, enthusiasm, and wholehearted support created a safe space for me to become a confident woman. This past October, he performed his last funeral. And his final homily was for his high school best friend, Russell. Usually, he loved doing funerals. They were his favorite. But this one was different. It was the first time I'd ever seen him struggle so much in a service. I imagine that Ray is feeling something similar to it. There are certain people who hurt a little bit more to say goodbye to. Certain special people who helped you grow to be you. The people who made my dad better and happier. Russell and Ray are some of those special people. I want to remember my dad as the author of my favorite memories. His unique talent for creating fairy tale moments was truly special. His love for surprising my mom was a testament to the romantic spirit that defined their relationship. The joy he found in bringing unexpected moments of happiness showcased his thoughtful and caring nature. Whether it was a simple gesture or an elaborate surprise, the sparkle in my mom's eyes mirrored the joy he took in making her happy. His protective instincts for my sister, creating a shield of love and support. In moments of conflict, his strength became a comforting presence and the pride he took in her accomplishments resonated with him in his unwavering support. One of his remarkable abilities was having friends everywhere. His magnetic personality and genuine connections meant that his friendships were enduring bonds that spanned a lifetime. His capacity to remember people and their stories demonstrated a sincere interest in their lives and the lives of those he met, making everyone feel seen and valued. A storyteller who wove the narratives of people's lives into the fabric of his own. The happiness he radiated and the love he shared are the threads that will forever define the way I remember my dad. Before my final thought, I want to thank all of you for caring about my dad and being with us today. I think he would have loved to have seen everyone. And thank you to those who are here in spirit watching from their homes. And thank you to my Godfather, Rick Tates, for doing this hard thing. And finally, my dad's last words. In my dad's eyes, Donna Warren embodies the definition of grace. He admired your dignity and the extraordinary ability to maintain composure in difficult trials. Her character left a major impression on him, and he wished for me to cultivate those same virtues. His last words to me in person were, "Be like Donna. Be like Donna." A request for how he hoped I would navigate the darkness and trials I will surely face. Expressing his enduring wish for me to carry Donna's spirit and admirable qualities. She is kind. She's calm. She's beautiful. She's smart. And she is fun. "Be like Donna," he said. "Be like Donna."
I would like to invite you to please open your hymnals as we will be singing together the chosen hymn of this service, hymn number 12, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee," and we will be singing all three verses.
Yes.
Thank you, each one, for coming this afternoon. It's very much appreciated. Thank you particularly to Glendale City Church and Doug Schultz for walking in Casey home so joyfully and abundantly. Debbie and Adrian and Madison, I'm grateful for the invitation to share this moment with you this afternoon. Rosie's down with COVID today, or she'd be sitting right next to you. Adrian is better at keeping her composure than I am, so this could be a rocky road. Drew and Cassie send their love in acknowledgement of the special relationship that only our four children share and understand, something to do with the roads in Maryland, love being the operative word. Our families have what you'd call history, some of which we'll admit. 41 years ago today, this year, in 1983, Debbie and Casey and Rosie and I celebrated our 30th birthdays together in that fellowship hall right there. In a few minutes, we'll go there for a reception in honor of Casey's memory. At that event, Adrian was just a wee little thing. As long ago as that seems, it's still too short a time between this moment and that one. Let us pray. God our Father, we pray now for the peace that passes understanding. Amen. Of all the things that we could talk about and reflect upon from the last 71 years, perhaps the most relevant right now is this. Casey is at rest. Our brother, father, husband, colleague, and friend is resting in the arms of God's grace. As Adrian said recently, Casey was called on to perform the task that I'm taking up today, to speak comfort and solace at a memorial service for one of his best friends from high school. And on that occasion, Casey chose the scripture that Nadine and Robert read for us today. To an audience of people who had known him all of his life, Casey chose to affirm the hopeful message of 1 Thessalonians, because that is what he believed. And as a believer, Casey found his own comfort and solace in the words of St. Paul. Each of us, I think, regardless of our religious traditions, our background, our worldview, can find meaning in those words as powerful metaphors of the arc of our lives, of the universal experience of grief, the human optimism that thrives and survives in spite of circumstance, and the importance of loving and supporting one another. The apostles' words can give each of us hope. I think this is why Casey loved those verses and what enabled a peaceful passing. I'm grateful that Casey is at rest. But we are not at rest. The powerful words of hope in the scriptures are not a benediction for us, but are important because of what we still must face. We are grieving. We are mourning. We are not at rest. Blessed are they that mourn, Jesus said, for they shall be comforted. There's a linear order in that verse, first in the mourning and then in the comfort. The two are not simultaneous as much as we wish they were. Right now, grief, like a heavy fog, casts a shadow over our hearts. Each of us navigate a unique landscape of emotions, nostalgia, sadness, regret. Life with its twists and turns has given us joy and laughter. It's also brought us challenges and difficulties. Like the contemporary prophet Cher sings so wistfully, if I could turn back time, if I could find a way, but there is no way back. There is only this moment and the future. Casey is at rest. We are still on our journey. But if we allow it, hope will be our willing companion. Hope, like a flame that cannot be put out, flickers back as a presence of light in our hearts. The light of hope allows us to look forward, to search out healing, understanding, the gentle forgiveness that comes with remembering without any prospect of changing the past. and the warm embrace of a community that has shared the past and now faces together the future. Casey and I shared a great fondness for the writings of Frederick Buechner. We traded books with each other constantly. Writing about the passage that we just read together, Buechner proclaims, resurrection means that the worst thing is never the last thing. The worst isn't the last thing about the world, it's the next to the last thing. The last thing is the best. It's the power from on high that comes down into the world and wells up from the rock bottom worst of the world like a hidden spring. Can you believe it? The last best thing is the laughing deep in the hearts of the saints, sometimes our hearts even. Yes, you are terribly loved and forgiven. Yes, you are healed. All is well. About the challenges of the journey forward, Buechner wrote, we find by losing, we hold fast by letting go. We become something new by ceasing to be something old. This seems to be close to the heart of that mystery. I know more now than I ever did about the far side of death as the last letting go of all, but I begin to know that I do not need to know, and that I do not need to be afraid of not knowing. God knows, and that's what matters. Preparing this little talk today reminded me so much of the many years I did things like this for TLC, our library class. In a study group that Casey and I co-taught for many years. At different times in TLC, each of us shared this favorite sentence from Fred Buechner. What's lost is nothing to what's found. And all the death that ever was, set next to life, would scarcely fill a cup. Rabbi Harold Kushner observed that the words most attributed to God throughout the Bible are, do not be afraid, which suggests that the message that we need most to hear is, do not be afraid. Perhaps that's why this next stage of the journey, what we call the grieving process, as if naming it makes it any easier, can seem so impossible, so difficult. As St. Paul himself teaches in his writings, none of us ever get our lives right based on our own strength. How can we make it through this part of the process of being human and loving in a world that is broken and filled with disappointments? It's not Cher, but Don Henley who sings, the more I know, the less I understand. All the things I thought I knew, I'm learning again. I've been trying to get down to the heart of the matter. But my will gets weak, and my thoughts seem to scatter. But I think it's about forgiveness. It is about forgiveness. So, let's start this journey by forgiving ourselves for all the things that didn't happen, for all the things that could have been. We can't turn back time. Casey is at rest. Some things cannot be fixed, they can only be carried. Now more than ever, we need one another to make this journey together. The great Catholic priest and teacher Henry Nouwen wrote, the great challenge is living your wounds through instead of thinking them through. It's better to cry than to worry, better to feel your wounds deeply than to try to understand them. Better to let them enter into your silence than to talk about them. The choice you face constantly is whether you are taking your hurts to your head or to your heart. In your head, you analyze them, find their causes and consequences, and point words to speak and write about them. But no final healing is going to come from that source. You need to let your wounds go down into your heart. Then you can live them through and discover that they will not destroy you. Your heart is greater than your wounds. Your heart is greater than your wounds. This is Nouwen's great insight. We are greater than our wounds. Life is greater than death. God's goodness is greater than all loss. What's lost is nothing compared to what's found. Mourning what we have lost is the path to understanding this. Sorrow is not our name or our destination. I've quoted Sharon Diamond, maybe you won't mind if I reference Robert Hunter, the songwriter and lyricist for The Grateful Dead. Hunter is profoundly right about the journey we must each be on in his lyrics for Ripple. Reach out your hand if your cup be empty. If your cup is full, may it be again. Let it be known there is a fountain that was not made by the hands of man. There is a road, no simple highway, between the dark, the dawn and the dark of night. And if you go, no one will follow. I never knew Casey to be a deadhead, so if he was co-preaching this homily, he might turn to a literary character, one of his favorites, Simba. Who in the Broadway play A Lion King sings, I know that the night must end, and that the sun will rise, and that the sun will rise. I know that the clouds must clear, and that the sun will shine. In the end, God is our last hope, because we are God's first love. We leave our friend in his hands, and pray that we might be blessed by God's grace and guidance and abundant love in each of our lives and through all of our days.
Bow our heads in prayer. Father in heaven, we rejoice in your promises of love, joy, and peace. In your mercy, turn the darkness of our brother Casey's death into the hope of a future in heaven and a new earth with family and friends. You promised us that you are preparing a place for us, and we accept that promise by faith. Thank you for Casey's life and all the years that we shared with him. We know Casey touched many people in his life and encouraged them in so many ways. We now leave him in your care until the glorious day when we are gathered together in your kingdom. To this end we pray, in Jesus' name, amen.
Debbie would like to invite you to come and go to the school where Adrian went to school. We're going to have a reception afterwards over there, so we'd like to see all of you come.